occurrence where Christ was performing these miracles, these healings, and he was kind of making a name for himself. And so where Christ went, the crowds were starting to follow. They wanted to see more miracles. And as Christ and the disciples were going out into the desert and to a place where they could be afar, maybe pray, and they could do some more closer teaching of the disciples, these large crowds were following him. And the disciples were aware of this and tell us, Christ, we have to send these people away. There's no food out here. We have no food. They're going to be starving. Send them away. And Christ teaches a good lesson to the disciples right away. He says, well, don't worry about it. You feed them. He doesn't say, okay, I'll take care of this. He says, no, you do it. And he's trying to tell the disciples, who will become, obviously, the apostles, and their successors, the bishops and the priests, that you're going to be feeding the people. You're going to be feeding the people. So Christ performs the miracle, as we've heard many times. This gospel's read every year a couple times. And Christ multiplies these loaves and feeds the 5,000. And everyone is satisfied. Everyone is amazed. And Christ has to kind of flee the disciples. They get in this boat so they can flee from the crowds. Because the crowds come. They come again for him because they want to be fed again. They want to be fed again. They want to have food. Physical food that was given to them. And so as Christians, Orthodox Christians, we have to look at this gospel. What does it mean in our relationship with Christ? This feeding of the 5,000. Well, it means that Christ is the one who gives us not only daily bread, the physical nourishment, but he gives us spiritual bread. He gives us the word, the gospel. He gives us communion. This is all the fathers will say that this is a prefigurement of the communion, of coming to the chalice. He's feeding and multiplying the loaf for the people. But the people in the gospel didn't see it that way necessarily. They already heard about all of these miracles, and now they just saw Christ take 2 pieces of bread, or fish, and 5 loaves, and multiply them for probably 15 to 20,000 people, because it was 5,000 men plus the widow women and their children, so their families. It's a huge amount of people that were following him. And what did they want when Christ, after they performed this miracle, after they were satiated with food? They wanted more food. They came to Christ, they want to get it. And this is why Christ fled. He didn't want to be this rock star who was being a socialist movement, I'll feed the poor. That wasn't what he was doing, but that's how the people approached him. And I have to point out, brothers and sisters, that today, modern America, modern Christianity, I wouldn't even say Christian spirituality, approaches God in the same way. In the same way. There was a book written in 2005 by 2 sociologists, and it's called Soul Searching, The Religious Spiritual Lives of American Teenagers. So in 2005, 3,000 surveys were taken by American teenagers about religious life and spirituality in their life, what it meant to them, what they actually believed. Today, in 2017, these are young men and women now. They're in corporations, they're in the government, they're running the country in many ways. So what did they believe? It was condensed down to 5 points. All of them believe in some way this. God exists, and he created and ordered the world and watches human life on earth. He watches over it. 2, God wants people to be good, nice, fair to each other. That's taught in the Bible and by most world religions. 3, the central goal in life is to be happy, to feel good about oneself. 4, God does not need to be particularly involved in one's life except when God is needed to resolve a problem. 5, good people go to heaven when they die, period. This was the spirituality of these 3,000 teenagers, Christians, no less. And they were raised by people who were leaving the church in droves. And so most of these people probably, if we took the survey again, most of them probably don't go to church anymore. That's the reality. So this was the faith, and this is pretty much the faith of America. We do good, we follow certain morals, and we might get to heaven, because we're nice people, and we're nice to other people. And we only really need God in our lives, who created everything, when we need Him to resolve something in our life. Otherwise, we just try to be happy. This is all that matters in life, is to be happy. Let us be happy. This is American spirituality, brothers and sisters. And in this gospel today, the people following Christ fell for it as well. They looked to this miracle worker because He fed them. He took care of their stomachs. It made them happy. And they went back to Him for more food to make them happy. So what do we do, brothers and sisters? Is this our faith? Is this our Christianity? Do we go to God so that we can feel happy? Do we go to God so we can resolve a problem in our life? Whether it's a physical need, like we hear in the gospel today, food, or some spiritual matter, some financial matter. Is this when we talk to God? If we were American, probably is. Even us Orthodox, we kind of have this in our back of our head that this is what God is, right? We'd be kind to people. Our goal is to be happy. And God will look down on us and bless us, right? We have to admit it, right? We all fall for this a little bit. But this is far from our Christian faith. This is far from it. The sociologist went on to say in his book that this system, they call it moralistic therapeutic deism. So morals and therapy is what we get from God only. The authors describe the system as being about providing therapeutic benefits to its adherents. So they get some therapy from God when they need it, right? Just like you go to your shrink when you need help, some advice. This is what the people do. As opposed to repentance of sin, keeping of doctrines and traditions, living as a servant of God, steadfastly saying one's prayers, faithfully observing holy days and feast days, and building character through suffering. These historic virtues of Christianity are nowhere to be found in our society anymore. So we have to, brothers and sisters, not turn to God as an ATM, as someone that we only turn to when we need something. And we have to not think of our faith as one that we do so that we can be happy. If you want happiness, you will not find it in the church. You will find blessings upon blessings upon blessings. But they're often hidden away under a lot of suffering and anguish. As C.S. Lewis would say, if you want happiness, I have a bottle of port that will do that for you. But this is not Christianity. This is not faith. So what do we do, brothers and sisters? Why do we approach God? Will He not listen to us? Will He not feed us? Absolutely. But it comes with many other facets in mind. And as we prepare to take communion, as I hope we all prepare to take communion, each time we come with His prayers that we should be reciting. And one of them, by St. Basil the Great, and I'll finish our sermon, just so we can meditate on what is it that we get from communion, but not only communion, but from God, from our faith, from being Christians. And St. Basil tells us that we receive holy things, the holy things. We come to church, we believe in Christ for these reasons. For healing, for purification, for enlightenment, and preservation, and salvation. For sanctification of soul and body, for driving away every fantasy and evil practice and activity of the devil working mentally in my members, for the confidence of Lord of love towards thee, unto correction of life, unto steadfastness, unto increase of virtue and perfection, unto fulfillment of the commandments, unto the communion of the Holy Spirit, as a provision of life eternal, as an acceptable defense at the dread tribunal, at the judgment day. This is what our faith is. It's to change us. It's not to make us happy, because change is often a kind of a difficult thing in our lives. Sometimes it hurts. It's painful to change who we think we are. We're to be changed, to be purified, for salvation's sake. Not to seek out earthly means from God when we need Him at that moment to call upon Him, feed me, Lord. And it's not to be happy. I'm sorry, brothers and sisters, but this is our spirituality, the Orthodox faith, as opposed to American spirituality, which is a deceptive, deceptive thing. Let us be wise. Let us be wise when we approach our Lord in this manner versus this manner. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.